She's going to speak.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Cynthia Shore, the Executive Director of the Walt Whitman Birthplace Association, and we operate this famous historic site for New York State. So it gives me great pleasure on behalf of the Board of Trustees who are here today, and I shall introduce everyone in a few minutes, to welcome you, our man of the hour, the portraiture, William C. Rorick. Welcome, William. Sarita, she has been his manager, so to speak. We've been in correspondence, and she's been very helpful and supportive in seeing this through the framing and the naming and all of this. So thank you, Sarita. Very nice to have you here.
Thank you.
I know I was watching your interview with Star Jones, and it was very exciting to have someone here in the birthplace who has been on the TV show. And she said a few things that I'd like to repeat before Margaret comes up and gives the official introduction. But she asked you when you got into painting, and you had made the story that your father had wanted you to go in the insurance business, yeah. So you were very dutiful and probably responsible, you know, to choose that over painting at that time. And so you did go into that business, but it was around 1996 that you decided to be an artist full time. And he does portraits of deceased historic figures, male and female, of all walks of life, not necessarily literary only or political only. And we'll have to go on his website to see all that he's done in that respect. I will have a Q&A later on at the end of the program, and I will allow people to ask you questions, which will, you know, elicit more about your love of painting and how you came about it. So we'll save that for the end. And I would like to introduce our trustees who are here today, and then I'm going to hand the program over to Margaret. She will do your official introduction. So let me introduce Trustee Vice President Susan Fishbein. Mm-hmm. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And Harriet Spitzer, thank you for coming. So I look forward to the unveiling after your announcement, and after Margaret introduces you, we'll ask you to come up and unveil it, and we'll have lots of photo ops after that. So thank you very much. This is very exciting. We have some refreshments after the break, and I invite you all to come and participate in that too. It gives me great pleasure now to introduce our curator, Margaret Giardi. She is a historian, and she was also the curator for the fashion, you can correct me when you come up, for the fashions over the Huntington Historic Society. And she has given lectures here on the dresses that women would wear in the early 19th century, and it's one of our most popular presentations, but she only does it about once every 2 years, so you really have to catch it and be here when she does that. But the high tea ladies who come for the high tea always request to have her come and give the tour. So it gives me great pleasure to invite Margaret Giardi to come up and offer the introduction. Margaret?
Don't you do the lip thing, Cynthia?
If you don't want to, we'll do it together, okay?
Don't you do that now?
No, we'll do it afterwards.
Okay.
So, I am once again here for impromptu speech, and I'm very pleased today to be here to receive this beautiful historical portrait painted by a distinguished historical portrait artist, Mr. William Rorick, whom we will have an opportunity to meet and greet. And I just would like to say that this, currently, I'm going to sort of read some of his activities and memberships, so you can understand just how well-rounded and how distinguished he is in the field of art. Beginning right now, you are currently a professor emeritus at Queen's College, is that correct? Mm-hmm. And that is in the Department of Music, is that right?
Music Library.
Music Library, and you'll be interested to know that we have just been working on a music library here at the birthplace there was a man who collected musical scores out in California for many years, Frederick Burnt, and we received a donation of the scores that he collected over many, many years. There are over 300 of them, and we just finished archiving them this past summer, and some of the interns here have worked on it, is that right? Okay, so it was a very good learning process. In any case, that's something that the music, Walt Whitman music is something that's close to the heart of the workplace right now. So, Mr. Rorick has membership and activities as follows. He belongs to the Academic Artists Association, the Allied Artists of America, Audubon Artists, American Society of Portrait Artists, Arts and Crafts Association of Meriden, that's Connecticut, right? The Brush and Palette Club of New Haven, the Connecticut Classic Arts, and he was a publicity chair 1996 to 1999, the Connecticut Society of Portrait Artists, he's a member of the Hampden Art League, the Hudson Valley Art Association, the Kent Art Association, on the exhibits, Exhibition Committee for 2003, and many other positions in that organization. New York Society of Portrait Artists, and the Pastel Society of America, the Portrait Society of Atlanta, Society of Creative Artists of Newtown, and he held positions in different positions in that organization, ranging from artist member to board of directors. One thing I didn't want to learn about was, I know that there's a long history of artists that found Walt Whitman an interesting subject. As far as painters, I recall we have Dora Wheeler Keith, who painted a large portrait of Walt in oils around the turn of the century. We have the friend of Walt Whitman, Herbert Gilchrist, who sketched Walt Whitman out in Camden, New Jersey. We have Thomas Eakins, who was an artist friend of Walt, who painted a portrait of him. We also have photographers who have since become famous, like G. Frank Pearsall, Frederick Buttekunst. We have Matthew Brady and Napoleon Saroni, who made photographs of Walt that became artistic treasures. Some of them are on the wall here. And it's always been interesting to me how people select Walt Whitman as a subject. So I hope that you'll be able to share that with us during the question and answer session. I'd be curious to know, how long ago was the portrait painted? Is it something you did recently? About 2 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
And how did you come to choose Walt Whitman? What appealed to you about
that? Well, I like history and the arts, like history and the arts. And mm-hmm. He's very well known, and so I chose him, mm-hmm. and I'm glad I did.
Do you choose a medium according to the subject or according to what you have an urge to use at the time?
Well, I have a website, williamrorick.com.
Mm-hmm.
You can see my other works there.
Yes.
And they're drawings there. Mm-hmm. I like to draw, as well as oil paint
mm-hmm.
Section. That's where Walt.
And so Walt comes through to us as an oil painting.
Oil paint. Mm-hmm.
Do you mind if I
yes,
add
please.
Something? Because I've asked Bill the same sorts of questions,
mm-hmm.
and one of the things that you have told me is that the photos themselves speak to him,
mm-hmm.
so when he finds
yeah.
a photo that
yeah, on the internet,
is communicating to
there,
him.
And the quality of the photo is very important to
mm-hmm.
me, and in this case it was a wonderful pose.
Right, when I saw the portrait online on your website, okay, when Cynthia first told me that we're going to be getting this wonderful gift, I went to your website and I saw the portrait there and I said, that looks so familiar, okay, the pose.
It's up the right corner.
Yeah,
there.
It's right here. Yeah, and that's G. Frank Pearsall, who was a photographer, and he had a studio in Brooklyn. And Walt posed for him over a number of different occasions, and those are considered some of the best
oh, really?
Portraits of Walt. Yeah, yeah. So Walt was one of the few people of the time to really, really appreciate how photography and his image would sell his ideas and philosophies.
Right,
he was one of the first kind of celebrity savvy people using the new technology at the time of photography to portray the image that he wanted of himself to his followers and fans. So that's a very interesting selection of pictures of Walt, because as you can see, there were many.
Yeah, because the camera wasn't invented until about around 1850.
Mm-hmm.
So he was right prime, ready for
He was on the cutting edge. And his earliest portrait is on the far left up there, and I think he was about 28 years old when that was taken. And if I recall correctly, photography came to this country in December of 1839.
Uh-huh.
There was a ship that came over from France, and a man jumped off selling, I don't know what you call it, like franchises to open photography studios. We'll teach you the technology and you can set up a studio. But of course, everybody copied it and it spread like wildfire. People were moving out west and they wanted pictures of their loved ones whom they may never see again, all right? And it eventually became popularly priced so everybody could get a picture. So it was really a thing that Walt took, you know, and Walt loving himself, okay, and liking to see his own image, had many photographs taken, and he would write to his friends whether or not he approved these images of himself that the photographers took. You know, this is no good, this doesn't really portray me, this is wonderful. So I am sure he would like this portrait because he liked that photograph. So he would definitely appreciate it. So I'm glad that you changed your profession from insurance, because that was my profession too.
That didn't last very long.
I mean,
in Ohio, that's where my dad represented mm-hmm. Travelers Insurance Company.
I'm glad you escaped it early, because I had 40 years in it.
Well, you know, the thing that did it was when I was drafted into the Army
mm-hmm.
in 64.
Mm-hmm.
And I had all that insurance influence on me, and so I was on a ship going over to Germany where they sent me.
Mm-hmm.
And on that ship, I said, "Well, when you get back, what do you want to do?" And I said to myself, that was 1965. I said to myself, either art or music.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't have my dad around to influence me.
Right,
on that troop ship.
These interns here who are helping us work with our collection are trying to make that very decision right now. You know, they're helping us and they're trying to decide what to do.
You're born that way, you gotta do it.
Mm-hmm. Try, at least take a shot at what you like to do before you start doing something else, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That's terrific. So how long did it take you to paint the portrait?
Well, I think about 25, 30 hours maybe.
And did you start right away and finish it, or did you work in between like other artists do?
No, it was pretty steady. It was right now I'm working on a portrait of William Cullen Bryant.
Ah, Walt's friend.
And that's a side view of him, hopefully.
Mm-hmm.
So I stick with whatever I'm working on to the end, pretty much.
Yeah. Very interesting.
Well, Margaret, I'd like to get him up on the stage,
yeah, sure.
So when he answers
you. No, you can stay there too.
Oh,
wonderful questions. As a moderator of the discussion, you're doing terrific. I want to make sure everyone can hear his voice that is carried forward.
Sure.
So why don't we uncover this, and
yes.
Then why don't you stay up there with him, and or you can add some more comments or do some questions, and then we can also have questions from
sure.
the audience.
I'm sorry. Here we go.
No. So tell us how this works. Does the artist come up and do it, or do we do it for the artist? I've never been to one of these before. It's very exciting.
I think I can get the thing off myself.
Okay. All right, so I'll come up also maybe to give a hand, Margaret, if you're a little nervous. Okay.
Okay.
So please come up, William Rorick.
Thank you.
Yes.
the grand announcement. It gives the Walt Whitman Birthplace Association great pleasure in accepting this donation by artist William Rorick. So, Margaret, if you would like to continue your discussion, and I would like him up on the stage, though, answering the questions.
Why don't you take the podium, or it's either way, and we're open now for questions, Q&A.
Well, I would like him to say a few words.
Okay, yeah,
why
sure,
don't you say a few words about how you came about selecting Walt, and then we'll have some questions that will direct you.
I saw the photograph on the internet and very impressed by it. And I like history a lot. And if you look at my website, you'll see the other historical figures there that I selected by the quality of the photo, of course, that's important. And then I started in with the drawing on the canvas, and from there, I use an ivory black underpaint of just the values, the lights and the darks first. And they call that a grisaille, which in French means gray. And then from that dry, and then from there, I go in with the color. I invent the color, the flesh colors, because they're black and white photos. And all these, people wore black and gray back in those days, so it's easy enough with the color. And you invent the flesh colors. And then flesh really will vary according to the temperature of the light source. So it changes. So there's no one formula really that will work. I mean, because flesh colors will change. And so you pick a formula that you like. Usually red and yellow make your flesh colors, a little blue to neutralize it all. Flesh is actually orange, and then you neutralize it with blue, some form of blue, and you come up with a likeness that way. And, it's good to have good skills in drawing to start. That's how it works, and then you hold it up to a mirror, which reverses it, and you can check out, or hold it upside down to get the drawing correct. But the drawing is probably the most important element of all, to get your likeness, and then you do your color on top. He's a cool guy.
He thinks so.
Okay. Margaret, did you have one last question to ask, and then we'll put it over to the audience, or one other interesting note to add about our collection of Whitman portraits?
Our collection of Whitman, we have over the years, the birthplace has collected portraits of Walt Whitman, both by amateurs and professionals. And it's very interesting to see how he appeals to a broad range of people. So many people want to paint his picture. And everybody's an interpretation of how the person feels about Walt. Do you think this is an interpretation of how you feel?
Yeah, I mean, that beard is very much interesting. It's quite a challenge to do a beard. You start with your darks and your lights first, big masses of lights and darks and middle tones first. And then at the end, you put in your hairs, individual hairs. You get the form first, of the beard in the case, and the details later. That's how you feel about it. I did a portrait of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow also. That's up in the museum up there in Sudbury, Massachusetts. And that was, they all wore beards back then in the States, I mean, late 1800s, late 1800s. And that's up there in Wayside Inn, you probably heard of that, Longfellow. great site in Sudbury, Massachusetts. So, and that's where it came to the state. And then William Cullen Bryant, I mean, that beard was really, you know, quite a thing. He's all bald on top, and he has a huge beard, a white beard hanging down. And that's one I'm working on now. And so, yeah, they all had to be respected by students. Seems like.
And they're wearing them again, aren't they, right? And then they're wearing beards again.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
That's become the new fashion.
It's come back, I guess. But, yeah, I know I wouldn't want to have a beard, so.
You know, when I think about razor technology, it's probably better to have a beard and safer.
I just was going to invite Margaret to sit down.
Yes,
if you,
thank you.
She broke her leg over the winter in the snow, so we want to be careful. Okay. Susan.
So I'm trying to remember where we might have learned the color of Walt Whitman's eyes, but what's striking to me...
Well, that's a problem, yeah.
It's a problem, yeah.
Yeah, I wish I knew that.
We don't know. I don't know if Margaret and any of us know the color of his eyes.
Yeah. We do. Yeah. Many people describe it blue.
Oh, okay.
Greenish blue.
Blue, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that you know that that was the case?
Yeah, I gave him sort of a hazel.
Yeah.
That is a problem. In this, when you have a black and white photo, I think the darker they are, the more likely they are to be like a brown or a dark brown or maybe a blue, dark blue. But if they're lighter, they're probably a hazel or a greenish color. But that, you're right, that is a challenge.
It's not only a challenge, but it's something. I see the color of his eyes right away.
Yeah.
Somehow that, and I've seen many of these pictures and studied them up close, but enough so that it, you know, I recognize it. But it's just the fact of the color, and it's very potent. The way he's looking,
it depends on
intense.
The lightness and the darkness of it. I think that helps you to decide what the color might have been. But yeah, that is a challenge. Yes, sir.
Is the technique you use to paint, is it similar to the wet on wet? Because I know that trying to blend on a dry canvas is very, very difficult.
It's similar to what?
That where, like, a famous painter that I know of, he would take a liquid clear or liquid white, put that on the canvas first, and then use that as to help you blend your colors. You mentioned putting black on the canvas first?
Well, that's to get the overall design and the value structure of it right off the bat. And then from there, and the drawing, of course. And then from there, you go in the color and you break it down that way.
So is there like a black, wet on the back of the canvas? Like,
yeah, it's transparent.
I see.
Black. I do black as like a transparent color. You use turpentine to thin it down, and you can get a pretty good rendition of lightness that way. But then the color is just, you know, once it's dry, it's got to be dry first, but then the color. We'll go on top, and they all wore black suits back then, so it's not hard to take care of that, white shirts and stuff. But I usually work with people who lived from 1850 to 1920, maybe, in that period. They choose that period for their portraits. What's the ones on my website? Anybody else?
Yes. What was it about that photograph that drew you to draw him? I mean, he loved having his picture taken. We've come to learn that. So there, you must have had a chance to look at many photographs of Walt. What was about that one that made you say, that's the one I want to paint.
Well, it had his hands in there. I think that helps out a lot.
Uh-huh.
And that diagonals in composition are important for, it creates excitement, diagonals, like his arm and his hand and everything like that. Plus, there's a strong contrast between the suit value, which is black and dark gray, and the white in the forehead, so you get that drama with the contrast of white and dark. So that might have been the
practice. He's very contemplative in that photograph.
Yeah, oh, very much so.
Did you like that?
Oh, definitely, yeah. He was a thinker. He's a real thinker, as far as I know.
I just was curious, who's your favorite artist?
My favorite artist, you know, when I was younger, it was Thomas Sully, F-U-L-L-Y, inspired me greatly. And of course, I like Sargent and the other ones. Sir Thomas Lawrence in England, as a portrait painter, was a favorite of mine for a long time, along with the Sully. I think that those two inspired me a lot. There was an exhibit at Yale recently, a few years ago, Sir Thomas Lawrence. A great portrait in the
I was wondering if you ever do landscape portrait paintings.
Yeah, I like to do landscapes. I do it occasionally. I like that period in landscape history of American landscape painting called tonalism. It occurred about 1880 to about 1920, and a lot of it's very moody kinds of landscape painting, and with a dark light like a moon or something that gives you a contrast, but it gives you a feeling of, drama or whatever. There's one painting I just made a copy of what's his name? Shepherd. Shepherd's his last name. And I forgot what his first name is, but he did this ship out on the water at night, dark, going in that direction away from the ship, and there's a moon right in the back of his ship coming right at you, and there's another, like a tugboat or something out there, and then another ship way off in the distance. But the mood of that really captures my imagination. And Shepherd lived from 1858 to 1937. I forgot his first name. It might be Arthur. I forgot his first name. Shepherd's just. Yeah, I like that kind of moody kind of landscape painting. Yeah, I go out and I paint, the landscape painting from life. I like still life painting. I don't still like. I like historical objects in still life. I like history so much. And lanterns and candles and still life, brings back memories of history. That's a kind of subject matter.
Have you done any portraits of political figures? Possibly even U.S. presidents? If so, when? Yeah, have you done any of those?
Not too many. That could be a project for anybody else. Start with those presidents. Ulysses S. Grant. I did a portrait of him. It's on the website.
Did we say Abraham Lincoln?
Okay,
Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah, Abraham Lincoln.
Yes.
Abraham Lincoln.
Great.
And those, that one's up in, along with Admiral Doubleday. Has anyone ever heard of him?
Yep.
He's sort of an inventor of baseball. He was born in upstate New York, around Saratoga Springs. And Grant, Lincoln and Admiral Doubleday are in the museum up there called the New York State Military Museum.
Oh.
So the Lincoln one is there and Admiral Doubleday. Admiral Doubleday was born just south of Saratoga Springs.
When you have a chance to paint either in black and white or in color, do you paint in both black and white and color, first of all, is the question? And if
well,
you
just do black first.
No, I mean the result being not color, black and white. Do you have a resulting painting that you wind up being just black and white and grays?
No, not usually.
Okay, so the question therefore is why?
With what?
Why do you select to do color, and some people do
well,
black and
white? It could be the grisaille. You could leave it as a grisaille, gray, not black and white.
What are the advantages and disadvantages?
People like color for some reason.
You do it for your audience, not for yourself.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, you can do that. You can work that way if you want to. I'm sure historically it's been done.
I was thinking it's an artistic choice in what you're trying to convey in a picture.
I see.
You're making choices based upon what you want to convey, what you wish to convey.
I see. Yeah.
That's just my, question to you.
Well, that's up to the individual.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're an individual.
Well, you certainly have a valid approach. If you
mm-hmm.
feel you want to work that way.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I guess I think of my audience.
Okay.
No, it's a very valid, historically valid way to work. Used to be, they call it Versailles, gray, underpainting.
I mean, sometimes movie makers, they now have all kinds of technology. They might decide to make a black and white cinematic production for some reason. Which they is an artistic reason.
Yeah, they say that composition is the most important thing in art, I've heard.
Mm-hmm.
And then the design, how things are designed. And the black certainly helps it out. And the color is just kind of an incidental thing on top.
Okay, thank you.
The most important thing is how things are arranged in the picture first, and then they have the black. Helps to bring that out. Then I don't know. Other people, it depends on the individual.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a good way to practice. Is just like black.
Yeah.
And get your composition. Mm-hmm. And he's got a very good composition. He's, triangular shapes and stuff.
Okay.
Very strong. That's what.
Margaret, I was just going to ask, how important is it for an artist to join professional organizations to get work and to get recognition?
Yeah, I think it's mainly to get your name out there.
Mm-hmm. Advertising?
And to show your work.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them actually do demonstrations at these organizations. I've never had the privilege of doing that. I would say you should join as many organizations as you can. You meet other people
mm-hmm.
and friends and something. Definitely. It's very important. Outreach.
All right, after Harriet, I'm going to suggest that we say thank you and then have some coffee and donuts, and we can put these benches in a circle
mm-hmm.
and continue the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
I know that Megan is taping it, and we have a lot of background noise here, so I want the quality of the conversation to be better. So why don't I come up and say thank you, and then Harriet, you can ask your question.
Sure.
Okay. So let me take the initiative. Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Thank you very much. It was wonderful. And
And yes, losing one of them.